Good morning, BFMC. Happy Sunday. It is a much more beautiful day than predicted. So hopefully we can all get out there and finish our gardening today. Just a few announcements. The VBS is coming July 18th to the 22nd already for kids 3 years old through fifth grade. If you want to volunteer, I remember my days of doing VBS. You are so much more blessed by being with those kids than you could ever imagine. So you can sign up in the donut room when you get your donut, or you can sign up online. But volunteer and just give them some of your time. It's an amazing week. There's hundreds of kids that come from all over Brockport in the area, not even from this church. So be a blessing to them this summer. And also, Kingdom Bound for high schoolers and junior high, 6th through 12th grade, is the next week, July 24th to 28th. And I remember going to that. And I am going this year, not to camp, but I will be there for the concert. So any of you guys I ever taught, look for me at the concert. You'll be able to hear me, I'm sure. But make sure you get signed up with Pastor Mike, or again, online, you can get signed up to go to Kingdom Bound. There's some awesome concerts this year going on there, and the programs during the day. And then finally, on a personal note, I want to thank, I don't think she's here today, but Catherine Garrett and her team from our church did the Shameless Pursuit Women's Conference yesterday. Over 250 women came together yesterday at Pierce Memorial. And if you've never gotten to experience something like that, I know the men do the Iron Sharpens Iron and different programs. They used to always offer women of faith in this area. It was so good to be back together and worshiping God. The praise worship was amazing. We had opportunities to hear people's stories. It was just a blessed time. And Catherine shared how it was 10 years ago God gave her this vision for a conference like this. So just the big point of it was to be open to the dream God's given you. Don't shut it off. Don't think you can't do it. Because when God has something for you to do, he will eventually get you there, no matter how many times you may say no. So just be open to it. Be open to where your story goes. Be open to share your story, because God is going to use it in some amazing ways. And believe me, I'm proof you don't know how he's going to use it. But he will use it. So I just wanted to make sure and give a shout out to Catherine and her team and the people at Pierce that let us be there yesterday. It was an awesome day to just be refreshed, be lifted up, and just wanted to say thank you for that opportunity. So if you all stand, we're going to get ready to worship and enjoy this great morning.
Amen. Who's excited to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Amen. Let's worship him together.
You alone have made a way for us. God, I look to you. I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. God, I look to you. You're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom. You know just what to do. Thank you.
clap of praise this morning in earnest. God, thank you that you reign.
Aren't we a blessed people? Praise God. Kathy talked about the women's conference yesterday. It was amazing. And I had the opportunity, I had the privilege of representing you at annual conference on Thursday and Friday. And that, right, Mac, was amazing. And our God is not a God of confusion or chaos. Both annual conference and the women's conference paralleled in each other. And we were called to dream again through the Holy Spirit, Spirit-led, Spirit-filled. God gives us dreams. And now that COVID's over, let's start dreaming so that God can conceive and grow and birth those dreams in this, in us, in this church, Brockport, and in our conference and across the world. I hope the world's ready. I hope the world's ready. Just a reminder today, God told his people in Isaiah 43, forget the former things. Do not dwell on the past. See, I'm doing a new thing, and now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland. And today I'd like to pray the words of a song. It's called Spirit of the Living God, because we need to let the Spirit fill us and mold us and lead us. Would you bow your heads and pray? Spirit of the Living God, we come today only wanting to hear your voice. We are hanging on your every word. Spirit of the Living God, we want to know you more and more. Come speak to us, O Lord. We only want to hear your voice, because when you speak and when you move and when you do what only you can do, it changes us. It changes what we see. It changes what we seek. You, Lord, you are changing everything. Spirit of the Living God, we are leaning into all you are. We will let everything else wait. Come now and breathe upon our hearts. Come now and have your way. When you move, you remove all our fears. When you move us to tears. And when you fall on us, we fall on our knees. When you fall on us, we fall at your feet. Holy Spirit, when you speak, when you move, when you do what only you can do, it changes us. Spirit of the Living God, come. Be that change in us. Amen and amen.
Good morning. It is good to see you this morning. The lights are going to, usually during the message we turn the lights up, but you won't be able to see the wall. We're having some tech problems and we've been working on it. I think we're going to figure this out and get it fixed before we know it. This morning we're going to look at Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2. So if you have a Bible, you may want to open it to that book. And God's up to something. We just came back from an annual conference, which is every year, and lay people from the church and some pastors go, and the Holy Spirit just broke out in a beautiful way. And I don't think Catherine Garrett's here this morning. She's online worshiping, and she should be resting up and worshiping. But we had 30-some women there yesterday, and the reports back, thank you, Justin. The reports back have been just so positive of what God was doing, and lives were touched in ways beyond human guessing. And I think sometimes, at least in my life, I want to play it safe. And because I want to play it safe, I get a little nervous sometimes when people start talking about the Holy Spirit doing unusual things. But the Spirit of God is at work. And when the Spirit of God is at work, unusual things happen. So I'm excited, man. I think something exciting is going to happen, not just in this church, but in the church plant down the street and the Baptist church around the corner and Catholic Church. I just think God's going to be working. I really do. So we're in a new series. And it's called Living Without Regrets. And this morning we're going to talk about if you live your life with love, if I live my life with love, you and I will have less regrets. I mean, think about it. The times that I have regrets are the times that I haven't loved. It's the times when I've been like quick on the kids or upset with Lori or something not going my way or the Bills losing a playoff game, whatever it may be, right? It's usually not been based in love. It's been based judgmentalness, pride, anger, short-fused, impatient. I have a friend who went to seminary in Kentucky, and he got asked to speak at a church. And when you're in Kentucky at Asbury Seminary and you get asked to speak and you're learning to become a pastor, it's a deal. You're like, yeah, I'll go anywhere. So they sent him to some church out in a really rural little county in a rural church in Kentucky. He was pretty excited. He gets to the church. He says, hey, I'm here to speak. And the person they're handing out, by the way, you should hopefully have a white piece of paper in your hands. It's homework, but it's fun homework, and it's good homework. And the person at the church door said, oh, I hate to tell you this. We have a church split that just happened about 2 months ago. You're not speaking at this church. Our pastor's here. You're speaking at a house that's like a mile and a half down the road. He goes, how am I going to find it? He said, just keep going down the road, and you'll see the sign. So he's driving down the road. He's thinking, oh, man, I'm driving to this house. And all of a sudden, he sees an old refrigerator box turned inside out, and it's got the church name, and it's spray painted in black spray paint on the church's name. So he's not so excited right now. And he goes up, he rings the doorbell, he says an older gentleman opens the front door, and it's a glass door, and he opens the door and he goes, can I help you? And then he shuts the glass door. And he said, I'm here to speak, I'm from the seminary. And he looks my friend up and down, and then he shakes his head in disapproval because of the way he's dressed. This is absolutely true. There's no, you know, sometimes you put a little jam on the bread, there's no jam, this is absolutely true. And then he finally cracks the door and he said, you're the boy they sent to preach? He said, yeah. He said, tuck in your shirt. So he tucks his shirt in. And he wanted to say, no, I'm not the guy that's here to preach. I'm here because this place is so friendly and your sign is so creative and beautiful, right? He said, okay. So he leads him into the living room. There's about 8 adults sitting in this living room. And the guy that opened the door sits in a big lazy boy chair and just sits there. And he says, don't you know you're supposed to lead us in a time of singing? And this guy doesn't know. He's like me. He doesn't know how to sing. And he said, so what we usually do is just ask for your favorite hymn. So he gets up, young guy from seminary, says, what are your hymns do you want to sing? And they shout out at him. And so he stands there. And the other guy's now in the lazy boy with his eyes closed, and these 8 people start to sing the hymn. The problem is nobody's singing the hymn. It's only him, and there's 7 people watching him, and the 8th person's sleeping. And at any minute, he expects his friends from seminary to jump out of the room and say, surprise, we got you. But nobody yells, surprise, we got you, because this is, like, serious what's going on here, just wishful thinking. So he sings 3 specials. Remember when church just had specials? Back in the day, someone would come up and sing a solo, and they call them a special. So he basically does 3 specials. He leads them in 3 hymns, but no one sings. It's just him singing. And he gets done singing, and they hand him a Cool Whip. Remember your Cool Whip container? And they say, now we have an offering. And so he gives them the Cool Whip container. He goes to pass it out. He goes, no. Now the guy's awake, and the lazy boy, he says, we sing the doxology. You know, beautiful, praise God from whom all blessings flow. So he does another solo and sings a doxology, and he's thinking, there is no way in the world this church is going to explode in growth. I just don't see it happening. And so he goes ahead and he preaches. The guy in the lazy boy chair falls asleep. And when he goes to leave, before he gets done, he gets done with the sermon, he's getting ready to leave, and they say this, hey, before you leave, we always give an altar call if anyone wants to give their life to Christ. And he's thinking, is Rip Van Winkle going to give his life to Christ? Like, and the squirrels outside, like, who are you expecting to give their life to Christ this morning with the 89 of us that are in the room? He went to shake the woman's wife or the guy who sat in the lazy boy chair's hand, and he said, well, thanks for having me. And she said, well, it was nice to have you. See you later. And she just didn't even shake his hand. And it's kind of a funny story, other than my friend said he left so discouraged. He was just so discouraged. He wasn't discouraged in the eight people. He was just discouraged in the church. He's like, what's happened? Here's this church, and they split. Half the people left or stayed, and, you know, this small church, and eight people left, and some people are just so fed up, they're going nowhere now. And this place is so lacking of love. Like, you can have a refrigerator box with a sign spray painted on it, and it won't matter if the place is filled with love. But everybody was joyless, they were apathetic, and they were angry. And he left just sad at the state of the church in that moment. There are two words, I think, that are really misunderstood in the world today. One of them is Christian, and the other one is church. One is Christian, and the other one is church. Now, let me give you a basic grammar lesson, and I'm not that good with grammar. Kathy Saley told me, her husband Joe, who passed away, bless Joe's heart. I was Joe's pastor in Batavia, and I would send Joe's notes occasionally, and she said that Joe saved those notes, which touched my heart. But she also said, you don't know how to spell Andy. I spelled pastor, P-A-S, I said, you know, I sent a note to Joel, and then after Joel at the bottom, I said, from Pastor Andy, and I spelled pastor, P-A-S-T-E-R. That's not how you spell pastor, right? It's P-A-S-T-O-R, and I've been doing this a while. I'm a bad speller. But I'll give you a grammar lesson, because I did some homework. The word Christian and the word church are both nouns. They are a noun. And the reason, though, their nouns can be misunderstood, it's because they have failed at times to realize that nouns need verbs. Nouns need verbs. For me to say, I love Lori, I need to love Lori, my wife, by actually putting action and doing things into it. It's the verb that counts. A noun without a verb, it just, you can't fulfill your purpose if you're a noun, but you don't put verbs to it. In fact, if the noun Christian and the noun church, if you divorce it from any kind of action, you will lose your purpose. And without action, the church loses its weight. And by weight, I don't mean throwing its weight around. I mean having weight in the world to help the world make clear decisions and holy decisions and godly decisions and righteous decisions and good decisions. And the church will also, without verbs, will lose our beauty. So if I were to ask you, what verb comes to your mind when you think of the word Christian or church? Think about that for a minute. When you think of the word Christian or church, what verbs come to your mind? What actions come to your mind? Christians blank. When you think of that, Christians, what do they do? Christians blank. And when you think about it and think about the ministry and you think about how Jesus treated people and you think about what Jesus did with people, that's what we should be like. So on the count of three, I want everybody to fill in the blank and just yell it out loud, okay? Christians, and you fill in your blank. Whatever word comes to your mind, it's a verb, right? So on the count of three, yell it out. One, two, three. Christians? Christians? Okay. Christians give money to their pastors. I'm just kidding. That didn't come out. Shame on you. One more time. Christians. Oh, yes. Kathleen. There were a lot of things. Somebody I heard said serve. Different things kind of came out loud. Let me challenge you to one, and I heard this one a lot, and it's good because it says something good. Whatever we said are good as long as they're verbs, but I'm going to challenge you that the one that came to my mind this week when I thought about it is simply is this, love. Christians love. We love. The natural outflow of Christians love, the individuals, Christians are individuals, the church is all of us together, means that we ought to love. When people look at BFMC, they ought to say, those are people that love. They love. And when you stop and you take time and you pay ridiculous attention to Jesus, you can't help but love more in your own life. If you just stop and say, I'm going to pay ridiculous attention to Jesus, you're going to love more. It's because that's what he did. Because love is the essence of God. Here's the good news. God doesn't have love, because then you can say, does he have enough for me? Or does he have enough for the lousy sinner that lives next door to me? Or for the lousy person who I'm sick of hearing about on the news? Whatever, whoever that works out, right? No, he doesn't have love. He is love, which means he always has enough for you. And which means he always has enough for everyone in this world. It's his very essence of Jesus is love. And so it makes sense that as Christians and as the church, that we would be known for our quality and our quantity of love we give. Jesus said it best, John 13:35, your love for one another will prove to the world that you are my disciples. Back when I was a brand new Christian, there was this little song that said, and they'll know we are Christians by our. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our. Yeah, and they will. That's how they're going to know it. That's the verb. That's the action that should take place with the noun of being a Christian and being a church. Here's what it says in Acts chapter 2, verse 44. Really simple verse. All the believers were together and had everything in common. If you actually have a Bible in front of you, or I don't know if you can do it on a smartphone. I still haven't figured all this stuff out. But common would be a word you'd want to circle. Because what we have in common as followers of Jesus is that we've received uncommon love. We've received uncommon love that has radically changed the lives in this room. It's changed my life. It's changed your life if you're a follower of Jesus. And if you're not a follower of Jesus and you're here because somebody dragged you here, or you're here because you're curious this morning, it's a simple act of just saying, Lord, come in my heart. I say yes to you. Forgive me. Become my Lord and Savior. Amen. And he comes in with an uncommon love. So we don't have to hide, and we don't have to be guilty and hoarding this love. We want to share it to the world. We don't want to take this uncommon love and hide it. We have someone in our church whose son is a race car driver, and he's really successful. And his son loves the Lord. And Lee told me this morning, he said, you know, do we have a BFMC sticker? And I'm like, I don't know why. He said, well, we want to put it on our car. We want to put it on our car so when we're doing the races, people see that we love Jesus and there's a place they can go and realize that Jesus loves them. So we have one big thought this morning, just one big thought, and here it is. Uncommon love is humble. Uncommon love is humble. BFMC is a place where we all need Jesus. We're all on our way to heaven. And on our way to heaven, I don't know who said this, but I've heard it, we're not knocking people down, we're picking them up. On our way to heaven, we're not knocking people down, but we're picking them up. And I think too often in this world, Christians are seen as people that are knocking people down instead of picking people up. And that's what we're about, picking people up. It's easy to knock people down. It's harder to pick people up because it takes time and it takes action and it takes verbs. And it takes creativity. Do you know, if you haven't gone to this and you could use it, we have a group right now that meets every week just to help people navigate mental illness. If you've been through that incredible cycle, and I've suffered from depression in my life, if you've gone through these cycles of mental illness or you care for somebody that does, every week. And it's because somebody had a dream to say, listen, we need to be willing to step in and bring the love of Christ, an uncommon love. We can't just be a Christian noun. We actually have to have a verb. We have to put something in place and help people where they really, the rubber meets the road in certain places. That's why we have Celebrate Recovery. That's why we have all kinds of different things that go on here. Philippians chapter 2, verses 3 and 4 says, don't do anything out of selfish ambition. Don't do anything out of vain conceit. But in humility, consider others better than yourselves. Each of you look not to your own interest, but also to the interest of others. That's putting a verb into the noun of what it means to be a Christian and to be a church. See, God's love is for people. And he didn't love people from a distance, did he? He got right into their world, as uncomfortable as it was. And that's what we're to do as followers of Jesus. We're to get in people's... I thank the Lord for the woman that cut my mom's hair for 3 years. And at the right time, she shared Jesus with my mom. And my mom came home and said, I'm a Christian. And I had just become a Christian like 3 months before. All she did, this young woman, was listen to my mom and her divorce and finances that we didn't have. And she waited 3 years. And when the time was right, she said, Gene, I've been through a divorce, and I've had some tough financial times, and the God that changed my story will change your story. And God changed my story, my mom's story, in a beauty salon shop on Brooks Avenue and Thurston Road. Right, I see it in my mind right now. Do you know we have a Free Methodist Church in Tampa, Florida, that if you go there during the off season, that one of the New York Yankees goes to? It's one of the relief pitchers. And you know what the relief pitcher does at that church in Tampa, Florida? He's in the parking car ministry. You know when you show up, you see Bill Lee, and you see Bob Bratz, if you don't know them, that's their names, and they're helping you park and get in. He pitches for the New York Yankees, and he's in the parking lot. There's a political guy, you may like him, you may not, that has nothing to do with it, named Huckabee. He ran for president. Do you know where he is every Sunday? He's at his church. And you know where he is? He's in the parking lot ministry. If you go there, the former governor is helping you park your car and making sure if it's raining that you have an umbrella that he will walk you into church on Sundays. That's action and love. Thought of a story that I hadn't thought of in a while. It happened, I think, just a few years ago, though, about a little boy that they found out that he had a tumor, and he had to have surgery on his brain, and it was malignant, but it left a big scar. And the story sticks with me because our middle boy had craniosynthesis, which we didn't know what it was. Thank the Lord for Cher. Remember Cher? Do you know how old Cher? Remember Cher, Sonny and Cher? She just turned May 20th. You're probably saying, how do you know this, Andy? I'm a secret Cher fan. No. It was in the newspaper. She turned 76. But I'll tell you, here's why I love her. Because Tyler had craniosynthesis, which is your brain fuses together. And you start to have things grow out, like a bump out of your face, and you become deformed. There was some movie Cher was in where the guy was in it. And we had two pediatricians that couldn't figure out what was going on with Tyler. And we're like, look, he's getting disfigured. Something's not right. We took him to a third doctor. They said, don't worry about it. There's just something growth here. It'll happen. And lo and behold, Lori's at WIC picking up some cheese and peanut butter coupons, and she picks up the Red Book magazine. I don't even know if they make that anymore. And there's on the cover is Cher, and Cher's talking about craniosynthesis. And Lori walks up to the nurse, and the nurse goes, yeah, I just read this article. You need to have your boy looked. Little Tyler's there. You need to have him looked. And he did. He had it, and they went in, they had to crack his skull open and break it where it fused together. They put a piece of plastic in, and poor Ty had a mark where it crossed his forehead, just like, not his forehead, but right on top of his head where they had to do the surgery. He's just a little two-year-old kid, but that scar never went away. Thank the Lord, you get your hair from your father-in-law, right? His father-in-law's got a head of hair. Thank the Lord. So this little guy, Gabe, gets the surgery done, and the tumor's malignant. But he came home one day and he said to his parents, he said, I feel like a monster. I feel like a monster. The kids at school, they stare at me and they say mean things, Dad and Mom. They just say these mean things. So you know what his dad did? I think we got a picture here. His dad, we got a picture there. This screen just went out, right? Over here. By the way, you guys, when you see Justin Reynolds and Corey, thank them. They spent like 9 hours here just working on this. We're going to get new projection units. But His dad went to the local tattoo parlor and had a picture of the scar that his son had. And he told the tattoo parlor guy, he said, "Can you put a tattoo that looks exactly like this on my head?" And he looks and has the same scar that his son had. Isn't that incredible? Isn't that incredible? He said, "Now my son and I, our heads will match with a permanent scar from both of us for the rest of our lives." And he said this, Gabe's dad said, "I didn't want my son to go through that pain alone. I didn't want my son to go through pain alone." Hey, when you and I suffer, when you struggle, when you hurt, you have a leader. I have a leader. We have a leader of this church, and his name is Jesus. And listen, if he pulls up his sleeves, you will see his scars. The scars, good morning. We love you, Pumpkin. You know what she's saying? Amen. It's baby talk for her. Amen, Pastor. Preach it, brother. We'll see his scars. We'll see his scars. And his father did not want his son to feel that pain alone. And Jesus will tell you through his scars that I hurt with you, and more importantly, I hurt for you. Here's what Hebrews chapter 4, verses 15 and 16 say, over this way. "For we do not have a high priest who's unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who's been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin. For we do not have a high priest who's unable to empathize with us and our weaknesses. But we have one who's been tempted in every way, just as we are." God understands. He chose to hurt with us. Let me give you a principle, and it's simply this. It's okay to not be okay. And here's the whole Bible in 10 words. This is from John Wiest. The whole Bible in 10 words. God made everybody. God died for everybody. And God loves everybody. God made everybody, God died for everybody, and God loves everybody. Every so often, it's good as followers of Jesus to take out a sheet of paper, and I actually made one for you this week, actually Dee did, and to take out a sheet of paper, just A to Z, and just think about who the people that God loves. And I'd encourage you this week, that's your homework, take the sheet of paper out, and then just write out people that God loves under each letter. I did it this week. I started it out. For A, God loves ambulance drivers. He loves airport workers. He loves the people that fly planes at airports. He loves accordion players. Remember Lawrence Welk? Anybody remember Lawrence Welk's show? They'd have these accordion players, and somebody would tap dance to the accordion. Remember those days? Everything was just great. It seemed, you know, like the whole world's good after one show of Lawrence Welk. It was like everything's good. God loves adulterers. He loves addicted people. We lived in Cattaraugus, and growing up in the city, I hadn't really experienced a lot of rural life. And all of a sudden, I'm like, Laurie, I'm not kidding. There's someone with a horse and buggy going down our street. And they were Amish. God loves Amish people. God loves astronauts. God loves astrologers. God loves Josh Allen. God loves Aaron Salter, the security guard, the retired cop at Tops, who literally pulled out his gun and took shots at that young man, and only to have the shots bounce off the body armor and for him to turn back and kill this retired policeman. And Lord, we lift up everyone that went through this pain at Tops, every individual, Lord, both black and white. Lord, have your mercy. For B, God loves people who live in Byron, New York, the metropolitan area of Genesee County. He loves people from Brockport. He loves people from Bergen. He loves basketball players. He loves blondes. He loves brunettes. He loves old ladies with blue hair. He loves bullied people. He loves the people that were bullied. He loves the people that actually do the bullying. He loves brave people. He loves bitter people. He even loves burned out people. He loves Justin Bieber. He loves babies. He loves boy bands. Remember Boys to Men? Now that we've come to the end of the road, you belong to. Remember that? Jesus loves boy bands. He loves Brian Best, who is playing up here. He loves, I call him Home Slice. He loves John Brueger on the drums, his son Corey playing the bass. He loves the Bruegers. See, God loves Cambodians. He loves comedians. He loves people from Canada. Susie Davis, you're probably watching online this morning. He loves you, Susie. He loves Cubans. He loves Mark Cuban. He loves congressmen, and if he loves congressmen and congresswomen, he probably also loves crooks and cheaters. He loves people on crystal meth. He loves children. He loves my Aunt Carol. He even loves cat lovers. He loves Steph Curry. He loves Cher. Dee. This is just my list, but have a list and be creative and have fun with it. God loves dads. God loves Puff Diddy, P. Diddy, whatever name he's going by, but he loves them, right? He loves dentists. He loves the Dave Matthews Band. He loves the Dave Crowder Band. He loves Deadheads. He loves drag racers. He loves Dolly Parton. I just heard Dolly Parton be interviewed, and she said the worst advice she was given, the worst, she's got a book coming out, Run, Row, Run. She wrote it with Patterson, famous author. And she said the worst advice she was given, they asked her. She said, oh, it happened all the time, especially early on. Everyone said, don't dress so cheap. And get rid of those blonde wigs. Did you know that her blonde hair is a wig? And she said that was the worst advice anyone ever gave her. She said she wanted to be the glam girl for country music. What a country music girl would look like with a glam look, that's what she wanted to look. And she said if she would have listened to all those people who said, don't dress so cheap, get rid of that cheap blonde wig, she said she never could have stayed her. And God has used her. As a matter of fact, there's a group called King and Country, which teenagers love. And she did a duet with King and Country, and it just, she killed it. It was like teenagers were listening to Dolly Parton. He loves disc golfers. He loves disc golfers. We got a great disc golfer in this church. He loves disc jockeys. He loves Donald Trump. He loves Ellen DeGeneres. He loves the actors from the show Dukes of Hazzard. Remember Dukes of Hazzard? Do you know, this is absolutely true. When we were married and the kids were little, Lori worked as an emergency room nurse. So I had the kids from 2 in the afternoon, and Lori didn't get home till 2 in the morning. So we lived on tuna fish. I had Dad's toast shop. I would make toast and put footballs with cinnamon sugar and their initials, because I'm not a cook. And then it would be story time before they went to bed. One night I had no story. The boys were like 7 and 8, and Kara was probably like 4. And so I told them that Lori was the original Daisy Duke on the Duke Show. And that, because they had just watched the rerun of the Dukes and Hazzards, right? And they were like, no, Dad, are you serious? Oh, yeah. Well, what happened? Well, Mom had to step down when she decided to have kids, and then she had to become a nurse instead of Daisy Duke, but she was the first Daisy Duke. And the boys were smart enough to think, even at 7 and 8, Dad's full of it, right? Not Kara. Kara went to school, and 3 days later, it was the time to share, and she shared to the whole class, and the teacher let us know. I didn't know that Lori was the original Daisy Duke. And she looks like Daisy Duke to me, but it wasn't true. So we had to sit down with Kara and tell her that your father's a liar. Yeah, the local pastor in town is a liar. God loves evangelicals. God loves Elvis impersonators. God loves evolutionists. God loves environmental activists. God loves EMTs. God loves elementary school teachers. Bless your heart. God loves, he loves electricians. You get where we're going, right? Grab a sheet this week and just, it will help your world to get bigger and to realize people who you may not want to love. that God loves them. And so should we as a church. Rich Mullins wrote this. He was a Christian writer and musician and died, unfortunately, way too early. But I love this quote. Do we got his quote? Yeah, I love this. The church isn't full of hypocrites. There's always room for one more. Isn't that great? There's like always room for one more hypocrite to join us and be a part of us. So today, I want you to know one thing. 10 words that sum up the Bible. God made you. God died for you. And God loves you. As we wrap this up, one last story. And it's a story I've shared a few times here. And I share it because it's so real to me, and it epitomizes what we're talking about. We had the fortune when the kids were little to go to Ocean City, Maryland every year. There was another pastor that had a condo, and occasionally I would speak at his church, and then he would let me stay there for free. And then other times we would just rent it out. And if you rented it out at the end of the summer, you got 17 days for the price of 2 weeks. And it gave you 3 Sundays to be there, the way it worked out. So we, on vacation, go to church. We sit in the back, because you just don't know what's going to happen. But we're there. And we went into this church. It was Lutheran. It was on Main Street, downtown Ocean City. It's still there. We figured this is a safe place to go. It says Contemporary Service, Lutheran Church. Let's go there. We walk in. And the place was chaotic. The worship team was all up front talking to each other. And then they started praying. And they got ready to start the service, and they start singing these corny songs. And I'm getting a little judgmental, like, don't they know how to do church here? I mean, the thing's kind of a chaotic mess. And then all of a sudden, one of the people on the worship team says to his daughter in the sound room, why don't you come down and talk about what's going on? You're going to college. This is during the service. She goes, no, I'm okay, Dad. No, I don't want to do it. Yes, you do. You come forward. No, Dad, I don't want to come forward. Get up here and tell people about what's happened to your life and God. Teenage girl comes walking down, senior in high school. I'm just thinking, this place is crazy. This is just a mess. Don't they know how to do church? I'm just being honest with you. That's what I'm thinking. Mac, you, Pastor Bob, you guys, you would be thinking the same thing. And the girl comes down, and she says, I don't really want to talk. And he goes, just talk. And she says, you know, I was far from God. My dad talked me into joining the tech team. I can't sing or do anything music, but I love music. And these people have just loved me and embraced me. And my senior year in high school, I've fallen back in love with Jesus because I've been a part of the tech team. Tears rained down her face. And she goes, I'm done. And she walks back and does that. The minister comes out to preach. He's got the white collar, the whole deal on, and he's preaching like this. I'm not kidding you. This is how he's preaching. And some of you have heard this story before. And my neck is getting sore because I'm turning left and right. He's just walking all over the place talking. And, of course, I'm sitting there thinking, don't you know how to preach? You don't walk to the back and up to the front. And he's just walking, man. It's just something I never experienced. And they get done, and it's the last song. And they say, we're going to sing the happy song now. And the whole worship team's up there, and they have these little stickers. And they're singing, happy song, happy song. And they're walking up and they're putting stickers on people. And my 11th grade son says, they're not putting it on me, Dad. And I'm like, oh, yes, they are. Happy song, don't you make a scene, kid. When they put it on you, put it on you. You ever been there as a parent? And as we're singing the happy song, I look in the bulletin, and this church is at least 3 to 4 times larger than the one I pastor. And they shared about how up to that point, like 43 people had given their life to Jesus that summer. And I just remember, forgive me, they get it, I don't. They get it, I don't. What was the difference? It was love, man. The place was filled with love. The service was all disjointed and kind of crazy, but it was love. And I made a decision that we're going to sing the happy song every Sunday from now on. And we'll get Pat and Adita to put stickers on you. Let's pray. Father, you don't care about the look. You care about the love. And we pray, Lord, that as we sit down with these sheets and we put down people, some obviously that are kind of just fun, but others that are close to us that maybe we struggle with, that you would help us as individuals and as a church be better at loving. Loving those that it's easy to love and loving those that aren't easy to love, because you loved everyone, Jesus. Matter of fact, the unlovable are the people we often found you with in Scripture. Help our church to be that way. We can't do it on our own. We need a fresh touch of your Holy Spirit. And in uncommon ways, fall on each of us in this room and soften our hearts and give us a Spirit-led boldness that would show your love in real ways. And that people would look at BFMC and they would say, those people love. They know how to love. And it would be an uncommon love that's found in Jesus. And I think we'll be happy. At least happier. Amen. Hey, let's stand and sing as we close our time together. There's worship boxes out there if you'd like to give to the Lord this morning. But let's close our time in just worshiping God.
Shadow you won't light up.
lift him up one more time as we sing this. And remember all he's done for us.
And all the
with a clap of praise this morning. God, thank you. Thank you for your love, Lord. Thank you for your love. Amen. Amen. Have a great week, everyone. God bless you.